Welcome to West Valley Christian Church Online. A happy Easter, or more importantly, happy resurrection. My name is Rob Denton, and I am the lead pastor here at West Valley Christian Church. We are so glad that you've decided to make us a part of your day, and we're so looking forward to what God has in store for the rest of this worship service. But before we actually get started, especially for those of you that are visiting with us, just welcome home. And we want to just say thank you and let you know that if you'd like to stay in contact with us, we would love to stay in contact with you. You could just find us online at wvcch.org or just Google West Valley Christian Church. And once you get on our website, you could check a box that says contact us. And we would love, again, to stay connected with you. I'm so excited, again, that you're being willing to share this time with us. And I'd like to just open up in a word of prayer. Father in heaven, thank you for this exciting day where we get to worship with one another, not just within the community of West Hills, but literally all over the world, as we've had friends from Samoa and Kenya and all sorts of other just states, from Hawaii to Colorado, just worship with us. God, may this be an amazing day of just focusing in on the hope that we can find in the resurrection of your son, Jesus Christ. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Well, happy Easter. Wherever you're watching, however you're watching, we just invite you to celebrate the risen King with us. We sing, he's coming on the cloud. Chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before Him. So open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings.
Stop the Lord.
fullness of the Lord.
So much for joining us for this Easter Sunday in these just these strange, uncertain times. We're going to sing another song. It's called Sea of Victory. And I love this song, especially at this moment, because it just reminds us that our God will be victorious. Our God's people will be victorious. Our God's church will be victorious. And we know that our God's kingdom will be victorious. So just keep that in mind as we go about our lives. As we practice social distancing, as we might feel that isolation, just remember that our church is strong. The people of this church are tuning in to watch just like you are right now, because they know that our God will be victorious. So let's lean into our church family at this point, no matter what we can do. Just be a part of that and remember that He is with us and that He is faithful. Amen. Let's sing.
Falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. Oh, my God will never fail. No, my God will never fail. And I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. And I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. And every war He wages, He will win. And I'm not backing down from any giant. And I know how this story ends. Yes, I know how this story I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. Sing that. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it.
Oh,
The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. In Philippians 2, it says, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Can you say amen, church? Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for what you have done for us. Let's continue to praise his name. Oh, praise the name. Oh, praise the name of the Lord.
Freedom, you have given
resurrection power, living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us freedom. No longer bound by sin and darkness, living in light of your goodness. You have given us freedom. Now I have resurrection power, living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us freedom. I'm no longer bound by sin and darkness, living in the light of your goodness. You have given us freedom. I have resurrection power, living on the inside, living on the inside. No longer bound by sin and darkness. You have given us freedom. You have given us freedom.
In his book, The Grand Essentials, Ben Patterson tells of a story of an S-4 submarine that went down off the coast of Massachusetts. There were many rescue attempts at saving the sailors there stuck in the submarine. Towards the end of this ordeal, there's a story told of a scuba diver that made his way down and could hear some tapping going on. He made his way closer to the sub and placed his ear against that thick, steel-walled submarine, and he could hear a sailor on the other end tapping these words, "Is there any hope?" I want you to think about those four words for just a moment. Is there any hope? Think about that. Today, our reality and our world. I don't think it would be a far stretched thought to think that maybe there's somebody in our own world, in our own country, in our own state, city, or home that are asking those four words. Or let me even draw it even closer. Maybe you're asking those four words today. Is there any hope? Well, I want to tell you with 100% certainty, this guy thinks the answer is yes. Let's pray. God, you know our hearts and our minds. And on this Easter Sunday where things are a little different than normal, we know that you're not different. And we want to just press into you during this time as we open up your word and we even reflect and think about that question, is there hope? God, I am praying that you would bring to our hearts and our mind the hope that is found in your Son, Jesus Christ. God, I'm praying for that person that's sitting on the couch or driving in their car or running around their block listening to this. God, I pray that you would fill their hope cup. God, help me in my weakness to be strong as I communicate your words here today. I love you. We love you. In the powerful name of Jesus, And all God's people said, amen. So what we've been on here for the last 5 weeks is a journey in a series called It Is I. I've been preaching here at West Valley Christian Church to a wonderful group of people as we've journeyed through the book of John. And if you're not familiar with the Bible, there is a book in here called The Gospel of John, which means the good news of John. And in there, Jesus makes seven what I call I am statements. And these I am statements that he makes helps bring clarity to more of who he is and what he is about. And so we've been on this journey looking at these I am statements. The very first week, we took a look at the statement where Jesus says, I am the bread. And we learned that that means that he satisfies our hunger, that he's everything that we need and more for our soul. And then the week after that, we looked at Jesus' statement where he says, I am the light. And again, we see him in a clearer way because when there's darkness, Jesus says, I am light. And again, that's really helpful for us living in this moment today. And not just today, but every day before this pandemic and every day after it, Jesus is light. Then we learn that he says, I am the shepherd. And we learn that simply meant that he knows who we are and he takes care of us and he's there to protect us and guide us and again, be there for us. He knows our name. Then we followed that up with the statement that said, I am the vine. And we learn that he is our power source and our life source, that he is the vine and we are the branch. And we talked about how important that is to be connected. And last week, we learned the statement when he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So all of these I am statements are helping paint a picture of really who Jesus is. And now we look at our last I am statement today. So if you have your Bibles, go ahead and grab them. And we're going to open up and we're going to take a look at John chapter 11. At this time, I think it's also great for those of you that are new to this. There's a great app on your phones, and it's called YouVersion. It's a YouVersion app. It's a free Bible app, and you could download it. And you have the Bible right there for free on your telephone. So John chapter 11, we drop into this story in verse 1, and it says this. Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary, and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, Lord, the one you love, and I think that shows us something about this relationship Jesus had with Lazarus. The one you loved is sick. So now think about Jesus. He's on the receiving end of this message, and he finds out that his dear friend Lazarus is sick. So if you continue reading on in the passage, which we're not going to for reasons for today, I'd encourage you to look at it later. But there's a conversation that happens, how Jesus interacts with the disciples and the information he's just received. But we could learn that it was soon probably after Jesus heard this message that his friend Lazarus dies. And we know this because it's about a four-day period. And if you work all your way down to verse 17, read with me. It says, on his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus has already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now, Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem. And many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to confirm or to comfort them in their loss with their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him. But Mary stayed home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask. Verse 23, Jesus said, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at that last day. Now listen in. Verse 25, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. And then he says, do you believe? Here's our final statement, our final I am statement. Jesus says, I am the resurrection and I am the life. I want you to say that with me right now. I am the resurrection and the life. Let's say it again. I am the resurrection and the life. Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. So when I said earlier that I could say with 100% certainty that the answer to is there any hope is yes, is because of this statement right here. Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. Now, when he shared that, I'm sure his audience did not understand exactly what he was saying. And if you fast forward 2,000 years later, I think it's probably safe to say many of us would also feel the same way. Like, okay, what does that mean? I am the resurrection and the life. Well, if you continue on reading the story, which I would encourage you to do, we're not going to do it today, you're going to learn that eventually Jesus is going to raise Lazarus from the dead. But this wasn't his purpose for saying, I am the resurrection and the life. It wasn't about raising his dear friend to life again. But there was a statement being made that would find its way 2,000 years later into our hearts and our home for what we are facing at this very moment. I am the resurrection and the life has power and hope for us today. So what I want to do with the rest of the time that we have together is I want to share the resurrection story. And then I want to share how that story has impacted my life and how it can impact your life. In order to tell the resurrection story, we got to go all the way back in our Bibles to the very first chapter of Genesis. And in Genesis chapter 1, you're going to see in the beginning, verse 1, God created the heavens and the earth. And then you're going to see that God created light. And then you're going to go on and you're going to see that, God separated the waters. And then we've got the sky. And then you're going to see later that he creates the land. And then he creates vegetation. And he creates the animals. And you just see the creation story here in chapter 1. But I want you to go all the way down to Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. Then he said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the air and over the livestock and the wild animals and over the creation that move along the ground. Verse 27, so God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, both male and female. He created them. I want you to think about that at this moment. I don't know what you're thinking about yourself. I don't know how you're feeling about yourself. I don't know what you're thinking about life right now. I know in the last couple of weeks, I've heard probably everything from A to Z on what people are feeling and thinking. I want to tell you something. For some of you, this might be the first time you've heard this. For some of you, you just need to be reminded of this. And some of you know this, but need to hear it again. God absolutely loves you. God made you in his image. And for that reason, that makes you pretty significant. Even though you may not feel that significant at this moment. So the creation story is wonderful, and it's a great place to start that God created us. And then you continue reading on in Genesis, and you find out that God has given us free will, and that's amazing. We can make good choices and bad choices. God created us, and he set up ways in which we ought to live our lives, not so that he could zap us if we do something wrong and applaud us if we do something right, but he knows us. And he knows what's good for us and what's bad for us. But he's given us free will to make the choice on choosing good or bad. And we find throughout the story that man and woman make bad decisions. And then we're introduced to this concept of sin. And then we learn through scripture that, like in Isaiah 59, chapter 1, where it says, the arm of the Lord is not too short to save, nor his ear too dull to hear. but our iniquities or our sin have caused him to turn his back on us. Now, I want you to hear something that's really important. God wants relationship with us. God is a relational God. This is a high value of God's. That's why he didn't create a bunch of robots pre-programmed to say, I love you. But in that, God is perfect and he can't have sin in his presence. And so this is what causes his back to be turned to us. So there has been a separation between us and God when sin is present. And as a matter of fact, Romans tells us this in chapter 6, that all of us have this problem. All of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That doesn't make us bad people. It just makes us humans that sometimes make bad decisions. And so there's a separation, and God wants this relationship. So he sent his one and only son, Jesus Christ, and that's what we celebrate at Christmas, right? The birth of Jesus. And Jesus came to this earth, God in the flesh, and he lived and walked on this earth, the very earth that you and I walk on. And we know through Scripture, and especially if you want to learn about his life, you read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and you're going to see and learn and hear about the life of Jesus. And you're going to see that he ate just like you and I did. He slept just like you and I did. Maybe he even got irritated a time or two just like you and I did. He loved the ocean and the sea, and he loved the mountains. I mean, he was human here on this earth. The Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 4 that he was tempted in every way but did not sin. So he even understands temptation. But towards the end of Jesus' time on this earth, which this last week, which we call the Holy Week, and then we just experienced Good Friday. This last week of his life, it got hard. And we open up our Bibles to Matthew, and I just want to just share a little bit. Again, we're not just getting the Cliff Note version here. We're getting the Cliff Note version of the resurrection story. But I want you to turn to Matthew chapter 26 in your Bibles. And we're going to be dropped into what we call the Garden of Gethsemane. And in verse 36, it says this: Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, Sit here while I go over there and pray. He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, My soul... I mean, here's Jesus, the Son of God, all authority and all power, God in the flesh. He says in the Garden of Gethsemane, My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Going a little further, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yes, not as I will, but as you will. Then he returned to the disciples and found them sleeping. There's a whole sermon there. Can you imagine? He just asked them to stay up with him and they fall asleep. Couldn't you even keep watch with me for an hour, he asked? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. He went away a second time and prayed, My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it. Again, there's those words, may your will be done. Again, you could read on in the story, but Jesus is arrested. Judas, one of the disciples, betrayed him, just like he had predicted. He is accused of a crime that he did not commit. He was flogged, and again, look up what that means. I mean, he was beat. Many of us would die at the flogging. And then there's so much more that happened. And again, you could read throughout Scripture the story in Matthew chapter 25 and chapter 26 and 27 of what I'm talking about. But eventually this led to the crucifixion, which again on Good Friday we talk about. Jesus' death on the cross. A horrific death. Why? Because remember, We're sinners. We've fallen short. We're human. We make mistakes. But I also want to remind you that God is a God of relationship. And because of that, Jesus died a horrific death on the cross so that you and I can have right relationship with God. Amen. That's the 90% part of the resurrection story. You see, we have a Jesus that's dead on the cross, shedding blood for you and I. And the truth is, if we're knocking on that sub, if Jesus is hanging on the cross dead, the answer would be no, there is no hope. But we continue reading the story. I want you to go to Matthew chapter 27. Matthew chapter 27, and we're going to go all the way to verse 57. So Jesus has died. And then in verse 57 of Matthew chapter 28, as evening approached, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate ordered that it be given to him. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of the rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance to the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were sitting there opposite of the tomb. So here we've learned of the life of Jesus Christ. We've learned of the death of Jesus Christ. Now we've just been taught about the burial of Jesus Christ. Now I want to bring you to chapter 28, verse 1. Matthew says this: after the Sabbath at dawn, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and he sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were as white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell the disciples, he is risen from the dead. He is risen from the dead, and he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." So we've seen the life, we've seen the death, we've seen the burial, and here it is, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He's no longer hanging on the cross. He is no longer in darkness. The fear and the anxiety and the confusion that all the people that loved him must have been experiencing must have been like the sub that sank to the bottom of the ocean, knocking on that steel, saying, "Is there any hope?" And then, 3 days later, Jesus conquers death.
Amen.
Jesus conquers death. This is why I could say, is there any hope? Absolutely yes. Not because of anything the world has to offer, but because of this book. Because of the good news that we just heard. You see, one thing I know is I don't understand this book completely. But I do know this. When God says he's going to do something, he does it. And here is why we can have hope today. Jesus is not hanging on the cross. Jesus' story did not end there. But he conquered death. That's my Cliff Note version of the resurrection. So there's more to those words than what Mary or Martha could ever understand when Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life." He was then, and he is now. I want to spend these last minutes with you just kind of sharing how that story has impacted this guy's story. And as I'm sharing my story, I want you to reflect, especially those of you that have said yes to Christ, I want you to reflect and remember back to how this resurrection story has impacted your story. I didn't grow up in the church. I had experiences in the church as a young Italian, half Italian. My mom's 100% Italian. So yeah, as we were little kids, I remember going on a bus to the Catholic church, and I remember ice cream, and I remember candy. And that's what I remember, and my sister and I would do that, and I don't think it was for very many years, but that's how my experience of the church as a young one. Part of my story is this. My mom and dad got divorced when I was two, so I never knew them together. I don't choose to say that divorce has ruined me. As a matter of fact, in a weird way, yeah, do I wish my mom and dad were together my entire life and we had the quote-unquote Brady Bunch family? Yeah, maybe. But that wasn't my story. But I actually don't look at myself as a victim of divorce. I got a great stepmom out of it and a great stepdad. And so I'm grateful for them and that part of it. But it did impact me just even, 4 or 5 years ago. I realized that I struggle with abandonment, and part of that was probably because I said goodbye to my mom maybe every other week as I was going from to go visit her, and that's not for today's story, but that did impact who I was. I had a great, just great growing up, childhood with a lot of good things, loved sports. Matter of fact, I'd say that sports was my God. And if you fast forward to graduation high school, so I graduated high school, and out in Orange County, didn't quite know what I was going to do. It was a hard time in our family. My dad went from being very successful to losing his business. So we went from having, the nice cars and the nice house to just seeing dad really struggle. And it was during that time my sister was living with my mom here in the San Fernando Valley. And she was a child actress and she was doing really well. She had all kinds of TV shows and movies. And so, I decided I'm going to go to junior college, and then I wasn't good enough to make the baseball team, and so I made the tennis team, so I was playing tennis, going to school to be a sports broadcaster, of all things, because I didn't know what I wanted to do, and my mom said, hey, Kristen needs a set sitter, would you be willing to come down and do that? And I thought, that'd be cool, I'd never done that, so I would drive down to the valley, take her to the set. It was a long day, long weeks, and once in a while, I'd go back to Orange County. This particular night, I went back because it was my first homecoming since I had graduated, so I was going to get to see all my buddies from high school. And so I did that, and then I got in my car probably around close to midnight, and I made my way back here to the San Fernando Valley, and which is about an hour drive with no traffic, and I fell asleep. I fell asleep driving 70 miles per hour in the fast lane on the 134. I went across all four lanes. I went through a fence. And then eventually, I was asleep this whole time. I woke up as I was going down this hill towards the LA River. And so when I was bumping, I thought, first of all, it's a crazy dream. I know some of you maybe have had dreams like that, but this wasn't a dream. I slammed on my brakes, and I skidded sideways, and now I was on this angle on a hill. And my car was completely smashed in on the left and the right and the hood. And I flashed my lights, but I was so far down off the freeway, no one could see me. And then I started thinking, oh my gosh, this car's going to blow up. And there's a lot that happened there, but basically I was eventually able to get out on my own. I ran up the hill. I thought I was going to go through the hole I went through in the fence. That made sense. And then get some help, but I couldn't find the hole. So I eventually climbed over the fence, and I'm running down the 134 at 1 o'clock in the morning. Some guy that just left his wife pulled over. And got me. Now, you got some of you going, why don't you call somebody on your cell phone? This was before cell phones. He took me to a payphone. I called my mom. I told her what happened. The cops came. And there's so much to this, but let me just say this. They found the hole that I went through. And the one officer pulled me aside and says, you are one lucky kid. And I said, why? Because I was 18 years old. He says, and I can't remember if it was 200 feet or 200 yards. I'm guessing 200 feet. I had actually driven on a utility road for that long. And just before a huge pillar, cement pillar, you see tracks in the dirt that automatically made a right-hand turn down the hill towards the LA River. My friends, I was asleep. And so to this day, I'm reminded of the grace of God, that every day I have is an extra day for this guy. That's hard to think about at the moment right now. I shouldn't have been alive. I should have died that night. And I would have died without the Lord, because I had many chances to give my life to the Lord, and I said, I'm too busy right now. Sports was my God. That was what was important. The next morning, my sister woke up, who loved the Lord and always tried to get me to church, and I always said, that's good for you, Christine, but not for me. Maybe later. With tears in her eyes, she was just glad to see that her brother was alive, and I just looked at her and I said, Krista, tell me about this God that you keep telling me about. She told me I should start reading this thing. She told me to start reading in the book of John. And so I started reading the book of John. That Sunday I went to church with her, and I don't think I've missed hardly a Sunday since. And that was 30-something years ago. I studied this book with two special people. Darren Skates and Steve Cook were two people that spent time showing me what God's word had to say. They explained the very story that I told you about, the resurrection, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. On April 26, I believe it was 1988, I gave my life to the Lord. I confessed him as my Lord and Savior. I humbled myself, and I got baptized. I want to tell you something. My life has never been the same. Am I perfect? Absolutely not. Do I still struggle? Absolutely. But even during a time like this in our world, it's hard to explain, but it's really easy. I don't have fear. I fear some practical things, but at the end of the day, I don't fear death. I have hope. I see opportunity, not obstacle. And the only reason I could do that is because Jesus has changed my life. Amen. I never thought I'd be one of these weirdos. What do you mean weirdos? Pastors. Those guys are weird. I'm one now, and I'd say yeah. But I'm just telling you something. Jesus is my hope. He has changed my story. And he hasn't just changed my story. I've been doing ministry for 30 years. We've got people that are at our church that ran in gangs that are now leaders. We have people that have been prostitutes and strippers that are now finding love, not with the opposite sex, but they're finding love because they're valued. And they're changing their life. We have people that are addicted to all sorts of things that thought that was what was going to take them out of whatever hurt and darkness or sub that was at the bottom of the ocean, that have turned their life to Jesus Christ. I see it over and over again. I see marriages that are broken, where sometimes sitting in the church, one spouse is on one side and one spouse is on the other. But because of Jesus, hope brings them back together. I don't know where you're at today. But I pray that you will know the Jesus, I am the resurrection and the life. And I pray for that person out there that doesn't even know this story until now, that this would be one of those times where from every Easter here on out, you will be reminded that that was the day that you said yes to Jesus Christ. If you're knocking on that at the bottom of the ocean or at the bottom of your life, I want to tell you right here, right now, I'm not the answer. Drugs aren't the answer. Relationships aren't the answer. Pastors aren't the answer. The Word of God and Jesus Christ is the answer. Amen. I want to close with a scripture. This scripture has brought encouragement to me. It's in 1 Peter. And in 1 Peter... there's a lot going on. And he shares with his audience these words that will impact my audience today. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. Praise be to the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his grace and mercy, he has given us new birth into a what? Into a living hope. Through what? Where do we get this hope? He says, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you. I hope this message has encouraged you. I hope this has helped to bring hope into your life, not just hope for this season, but hope for the rest of your life. Let's pray. God, the first thing that I want to say is thank you. Thank you for changing my life. Even sitting here telling this story for who knows how many times, I'm still amazed at your grace that you gave me another chance. And I want to thank you for the hope that I have. And I want to thank you for the hope that we have. God, for that person that's heart is racing right now, that has never said yes to you, I pray that today is that day. And for the person that has said yes to you, that has fallen away, I pray that they would recommit to you, Lord. And for that person that's walking in that hope, I pray that you would give them an endurance to continue to do so. God, thank you for being able to be directed to the cross and to the empty grave and to your Son's Jesus Christ. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
As we come to this time of communion, I want to read to you one of my favorite passages that the Apostle Paul wrote from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, starting at verse 3. It says, "For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance." And so he said, hey, listen to what I'm about to say. This is the most important thing I can tell you. And he says that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he appeared to Peter, and then to the 12. Paul is reminding them that the most important thing to know is that Jesus died for our sins and that he rose from the grave. And each Sunday, not just on Easter, but each Sunday, we remember this communion time to remember what Jesus did for us. His body was broken, his blood was shed, he died and was buried. But even more so, he raised from the dead. And so because of that, we have hope in him. Let's pray as we come to this time of communion. Father, we thank you so much for what we remember right now. Lord, I truly am so thankful that Jesus died, that he took my place on that cross so that I wouldn't have to. Lord, I thank you for the hope that we all have in the resurrection of Jesus. And Lord, I pray that this message of hope would be what we remember right now. Thank you, Father, for your incredible love. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and do you want him as your personal Savior? In just a moment, I am going to baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit for the forgiveness of your sins and to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go ahead and pinch your nose.
Praise the Lord.
This is my daughter, Ella, and I am very blessed
to be in the position to honor a request that she's made to be baptized here at West Valley. And she has made a decision to follow Jesus Christ, and that our whole family is just excited, and we wanted you to be a part of this. And so Ella, before I baptize you, I'm gonna ask you a couple of questions. Do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, that he came to earth, was crucified, dead, and buried, and rose again, and now reigns on the right hand of God the Father? And you receive Jesus Christ to be your Savior?
Yes.
Follow him for the rest of your life. In just a second, I'm going to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit for the forgiveness of sins and to receive the Holy Spirit. Amen.
There's a party going on in heaven right now. Did you know that? The Bible says that there's a party going on in heaven, that the angels are rejoicing. And so proud of you for what Mom and Dad have instilled in you, and then some people at the church. I know Katie Matsumoto has put a lot into your life too, and just so many people. So you're making this decision, which is the most important decision of your life. You've got your sister, your dad, and your mom, and your aunt here, and just picture the whole church filled out there just rejoicing with you in this decision. So I want to extend the right hand of fellowship to you and ask you, do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God?
Yes.
And is it your desire to serve him for the best for the rest of your life, to the best of your ability?
Yes.
Amen. Well, because of your confession, Calista, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit for the forgiveness of sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit.
As we come to our time of offering today, I'm going to pray in just a minute, but I just want to remind you all that there's actually four different ways that we can give. You can text WVCCH to 7797. You could give on our church app, or you could go online at wvcch.org. And lastly, you can mail your offering in to 22450 Sherman Way, West Hills, California, 91307. And if you're a visitor this morning and you're joining us for the first time, please don't feel any obligation to do any of those things. Just thank you so much for being with us today. Let's pray for the offering. Father, we thank you for the way you have continued to watch over our church. And Lord, we pray that you would use these tithes and these offerings that people give right now, Lord, that your work would continue to be done and that your mission would be fulfilled, that people would know about your Son, Jesus. Thank you for this opportunity that we have to give. Thank you for all that you gave us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Again, I want to say thank you as the pastor of West Valley Christian Church for trusting us with your morning, afternoon, or evening whenever you're watching this. And I just want to again reemphasize what was shared in the message. If you have not said yes to Jesus Christ, I just think today's the day. And you could reach out to us through getting in contact with us on our website, wvcch.org, and you could contact us through that and just say, man, I'd love to talk to Pastor Rob, or I'd love to talk to a pastor on staff, or I'd love to know more about who this Jesus is. Please do that, and don't wait an hour or 2 hours. Just jump online right now and do that. And then for my family that's usually here on Sunday, I just want to let you know I miss you. I know this is a different way to celebrate Easter, but isn't it awesome that you could close down restaurants and you close down bars and you could close down government offices, but you can't close down the gospel? And I'm glad that we were able to share in that today. May God bless you on this wonderful day, and you have every reason to have hope as we say goodbye. God bless, and see you later.